Amen. And welcome, church, as we rejoice on this day that God has made and join together in worship once again apart. We are glad that you are gathering with us today as we worship our God on this Sunday, this Resurrection Sunday, and we're glad that you are gathering with us from wherever you may be this morning. Friends, hear this call to worship from Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore. Let us pray. Gracious God, as we enter into a spirit of worship this morning, we pray that you would fill our hearts, fill our homes, fill our souls with the glory of your Spirit. We worship you in this resurrection season, knowing that you are making all things new. May you do that good work in us, your people, as we bring our hearts, our lives, and our souls before your holy throne. Hear our worship this day, and may it be holy and pleasing in your sight. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy. Your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on saying. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy. Thank you. The end draws near and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then
friends, we come before God knowing that we have fallen short of His glory, knowing that we are sinful, knowing that we are forgiven. We go before the throne of grace with confidence, knowing that God forgives us of our sins when we recognize and repent of them. So please, join me in our prayer of confession as we admit our sins before God, knowing that He is gracious and will forgive us of all of our iniquities. Gracious God, we find ourselves in circumstances we have not yet chosen, and we scurry to find any sense of normalcy. We know that You are the rock, yet we lean on other foundations. We know that You are sovereign, but we seek security in our own control. We know that You give comfort, but we elevate comforts of our own design. We know that You satisfy, but we keep scrolling. We know that You set us free, but addictions grip us tightly. We know that You call us to rest, but we keep struggling. By grace, forgive us, and mercy, meet us. By Your Holy Spirit, equip us to walk in newness of life with Christ. In Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, our sin may be great and abundant, but the glory of the gospel, the beauty of our Savior, is that His grace is more abundant, His love more powerful. Friends, know that you stand forgiven before a holy God and believe the good news of the gospel that in Jesus Christ we are forgiven. Thanks be to Him. Amen. Friends, we have a few announcements that we want to make and let you know of. And as you know, we're going to continue to stay that all things are closed at the church for the time being, and worship services are not public due to the COVID outbreak. But we're hoping, we had hoped that we would have been in the yellow from the governor, but we were not. But as the restrictions start to ease, we want to let you know the session is already discussing what it will look like for us to come back, and a lot of that's going to depend on the recommendations of the CDC and of our state and local governments. And so we are having those conversations as we speak. We just want to make you aware, and as soon as we know, you'll know. We're going to continue in our prayer groups on Tuesday afternoons at 3 o'clock. And so if you, whatever you're doing, wherever you are, please join us in the church in prayer, 3 p.m. on Tuesday afternoons. That will be ongoing throughout this pandemic. We're going to continue in our Bible studies on Zoom. And that's happening at 9 a.m. for our coffee and conversations. It's been pushed back to 9 a.m. on Zoom. If you're having trouble getting in, if you haven't been able to do so, just give me a call and I'll walk you through it this week, hopefully. And so call me on Tuesday morning and hopefully I'll be able to help you get in if you haven't been able to do so. But we have had a great attendance. We're going to be finishing up the book of 1 Peter this week and we'll be looking to start something new next week. We have Sunday school is still happening. Mike, if you haven't been getting his information, he's been emailing it out ahead of time. So we've been emailing out a Sunday school lesson for you all and for your kids. Youth group fundraisers happening right now as we're still hoping and planning to go on a youth mission trip this summer. And they're doing a flower sale, which Mike sent that information out to the church this week. So we want to let you know that you can do that. We want to give you just all the thanks and praise for the great gifts that you have given to the church and the tithes and offerings that you have continued to give. You have supported us. It's been almost 2 months since we've been able to be together, and our giving has stayed and in some ways has gone up. And so we are just so grateful for the wonderful gifts that you have blessed our church with. And you can continue to give online. You can continue to mail your checks to the church. We do want to make two other announcements. First, the shirts that we ordered are in, and you'll be able to pick those up Wednesday or Thursday morning from 9 to noon. You can do so in the front narthex where the double doors are, where the driveway is. We'll prop the doors open. You won't have to touch anything. The shirts will be in order of size. There will be a box there to collect the money and a check sheet just so you know, and you can check if you've picked up your shirt or not so we know who has it and who hasn't. You don't have to come get them, but if you would like to, you will be able to do that on Wednesday and Thursday morning of this week. And so if you ordered a shirt, they'll be available for pickup this week. And one final announcement, if you have not heard already, we mourn with our sister Charlotte Smedley as her son-in-law, Neil Conberry, passed away this week after an asthma attack that he just was without oxygen for too long. And we mourn with them and with Aaron and with the three kids that they have and just this devastating loss that the Smedley family and Conberry families are going through. We ask that you continue to keep them in prayer. We ask that you continue to support the family. And if you'd like to make a financial donation to help Aaron and the kids, as Neil was the sole breadwinner in their home, you can do so. I sent out a link to a GoFundMe page. But we just mourn with them and their loss. But we also rejoice in Neil's deep and abiding faith in Jesus that he has been welcomed home into the kingdom of God. Friends, keep them in prayer as this time is just so difficult to walk through in these moments. We thank you for that, and now we'll call Mike forward for our children's sermon.
Good morning. I hope this service finds you well, and if any of the children are nearby and you want to grab them and bring them to your television at home, that would be fantastic. It brings me great joy to be here this morning to bring this children's message and hope that you're having a good day. We're talking this morning, Pastor Steve's scripture that he is going to be preaching from talks about being in a difficult place. And this morning, we are all in a difficult place at times. We can become overwhelmed with just not knowing things or fear or frustration. And there's times this week where I struggled a little bit. There was many moments in which we put our hopes into things and into things that returning to normal soon. And we find out that sometimes that's just not going to happen as fast as we would have liked. And so at times it can be really frustrating, and we can get really just tired. And this morning, I know when I got up, I was tired, and I felt a little low. And fortunately, when I get in that, when I start to feel that way, in my office and also at home, hanging on my wall, I have the scripture verse that actually we're going to be reading from this morning. It comes from Isaiah, and I just have the last verse here, and it has a nice picture that goes along with the verse, and it says, "But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not be faint." And so that's a verse this morning that I memorized a long time ago. It's my favorite verse. I enjoy it. The message of it, the feeling that it brings me, knowing that when I put all of my faith in God, when I put my faith in Jesus, He will lift me up and give me the strength that I need to continue. Quick story, yesterday my family was out eating dinner on a patio, and this large, humongous bird flew over our house and around our neighborhood, and it shocked us, and we were taken aback at the strength and the huge wings of this bird. It ended up being a turkey vulture, so we were a little disappointed because we thought it was an eagle, but in the end, it was a turkey vulture. But it's still, the amount of strength and power that this bird had brought us, brought our attention, and definitely is a good example of this verse this morning, of the strength and power that we could be given to continue and move forward each and every single day if we just simply put our hope and our faith in Jesus Christ.
Friends, join me in prayer. Gracious God, we give you thanks. Even in the midst of struggle, the pandemic, even in the trials, you are still our God. Your glory is still great. Your goodness, indescribable. Your power, unfathomable. We praise you for who you are. We give you glory and praise and honor for what you are doing in us and in this world. We live in the promise that you're working all things for your good. We trust and hope in that this day. Father, we lift up our sister Charlotte to you right now. We pray for Aaron and the kids. We pray for Neil's parents, that you would just surround them all with your love and compassion and your mercy and your grace. That they would stand in the promise of the resurrected one who conquers death. Strengthen them in the days and weeks and months and the years ahead as the world has been shaken. May they live in the hope of heaven. Father, we pray for our world right now, who is experiencing loss, who is mourning, who has to let go of so many things. Remind us of your good glory. Remind us of your great strength. Father, we pray for our community and for our church. We pray that you would draw us together even though we are apart. We pray that you would pour out your Spirit on us, strengthen us, renew us, and give us hope. And Father, as we take a moment to pray silently before you, we ask you to hear those unspoken prayers of our hearts. good and great God. Make your glory known in this mess through your church. As we give you all the praise and glory and join in the words that Jesus taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Our New Testament reading and our first reading this morning comes from Paul's letter to the church at Ephesus, the book of Ephesians, chapter 4, reading verses 22 through 24. Hear now the reading of God's holy word. You were taught, with regard to your former way of life, to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
In the darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing.
I really just wanted to remind some of you of how bad your rhythm was when we played that video. We're glad that you're with us once again to join us for worship as we are apart. And this has been such an interesting and in many ways difficult season. Last week we started a new sermon series on resurrection and what new life looks like. It's called Being Made New, as we walk through the promises of this new life that God offers to us. It is a very interesting thing for us to proclaim in this season of loss and in this season of mourning, which is what we all are in. And really, in the season where we're all going nuts. It's been a hard season. And it's been a difficult time. And we all have opinions about what should have happened, what we should have done, what we should be doing, what we should do next. And we all have opinions about what it is. And we have to be honest about that. They are opinions. And what we need for each other, and it's good that we have those opinions, but what we need from each other is grace and mercy in this moment. Because the truth is, we're all just trying to do the best we can with what we have available to us. And it's not easy on any of us. It's not easy on anyone. But we also know that we live in the promises of God. And this God who's making all things new. But that's the thing about renewal. That's the thing about transformation. It's the thing about making things new. It's painful. It's not easy. It's hard to renew things. It's why church renewal is such a difficult task, because you can't do it without going through pain first. Because if you have to be made new, if you have to be transformed, if you have to be changed, well, that means that there's something wrong or there's something broken. And as we look around as a world right now, we at least our community, we're coming out of death and into new life. Just look at the trees or the flowers that are beginning to bud, the grass that is now growing nonstop. But the only reason we experience that new life of the new budding flowers or of the trees that are coming to fullness is because we went through the death of the seasons. New life, renewal, the promise. It's not easy. And that's this moment that we're in. If God is making all things new, if God is bringing about His new work in this world right now, using all things for His good, well, that process is not going to be easy. And as we walk through this season together, we have this promise of renewal. When I sat down this week to prepare the sermon on Wednesday, I went back to my notes that I made almost a year ago in preparing this sermon series. The last week of May, last year, I prepped this sermon series. And when I sat down and read it, I went, wow, that's relevant. And Nicole, our secretary, said from her desk, what are you talking about? It started with, are you weary? Are you tired? Have you lost hope? We are promised, if we turn to Jesus, He will renew us. We open our Bibles to the book of Isaiah, reading chapter 40, verses 27 through 31. Hear now the reading of God's holy word. Why do you complain, Jacob? Why do you say, Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, my cause is disregarded by my God? Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary. His understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary, increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's pray. Gracious God, we pray this morning that you would write your word on our hearts, that we would turn to you and be renewed by the glory that you pour out on us. We pray this in the name of our risen Lord, Jesus Christ, who brings life from death. Amen. My family has been on this video messaging app for the last few months, trying to keep us all connected, and every day we check in with each other and share what our kids are doing. All of my siblings, my parents, and the grandkids who are lucky enough to have cell phones are on it, and then even our kids grab our phones and connect with their cousins. And my dad started this thing that he would start telling jokes just to get the kids involved, and those jokes are dad jokes. Most of them are not that funny, unless you're a dad. Some of them are. Some of them are good. Some of them are tough riddles. It's been a lot of fun watching our kids go through that. And my son had a joke that he heard from his teacher on his online class this past week that really caught me. One, it caught me because it did chuckle a little bit. And then two, it caught me because it just seemed relevant about how I feel right now and what we're going through. The joke was that what do a triangle and a square agree on? And the answer is that the circle has no point. As I chuckled at that, I also, and the guys in the back, that tells you Mike Martin is a dad because he's laughing in the back of the sanctuary right now. And I bet Dave Friend is laughing at that too, which is why Zach is laughing at the moment. But I chuckled at that joke, and then it made me think about this moment that we're in. Because I feel like we're in a circle, a never-ending circle that has absolutely no point. Many of you, I don't know, I feel like I'm Bill Murray in Groundhog's Day, that it's just every day is exactly the same and it never changes. Well, it's quarantine again. We had this little slimmer of hope that maybe Butler would get put into the governor's yellow phase, that we could start at least to get back to a little bit of normalcy, and that didn't happen. And then that just sort of drove us deeper into the circle that has no point. I venture to guess I'm not alone in this feeling. And I venture to guess that many of us are struggling in this moment. At first, we made jokes about how we're just being called to sit on our couch and that we can do this. But as we've gotten deeper and deeper into it, it has gotten more and more difficult because, quite frankly, we're not made for this. We're not made to be alone. In my calls throughout the congregation over the last few weeks, and if I haven't gotten to you yet, I will. I'm working on it. There's just a whole lot of people to talk to. And the conversations are getting longer and longer, I think, simply because we are getting lonelier and lonelier. And you know, people aren't talking about how they miss their money. People aren't talking about how they miss their things. Every conversation I have had is how we miss each other. We miss our grandkids or our kids. We miss our church family and being together. Things that we used to take for granted. I hope we'll hold on to that as we walk through this and as we come out of this. We're not meant to be alone. It's not how we're designed. If you think about when God looks at Adam, he says it's not good for man to be alone. And many of us have found that to be true. And I was sharing with Debbie this morning that it seems like no matter where we are in our lives, in the station we are in life, we all want the other thing. You know, if we're alone and lonely, we're elderly and home alone by ourselves, and we don't have a lot of interaction, and we don't have computers to keep us connected to the world, they long for the sound of little children's voices. And if you have four kids under the age of five, you long for the woods where you can stand out there alone by yourself for just a moment, where somebody doesn't barge in on you in the bathroom. You see, we're all in this moment, in this time, where we've had enough of where we are. Where we long for what was. We mourn what has been lost. And that's this season that we're in right now, isn't it? We've had enough. The irony is we have less to do than ever before, but we're tired and we're worn out and we're weary. We're weary for a broken and hurting world. We're tired of what we have to keep on doing in order to protect our neighbors and our community. We're tired of what we're being asked to continue. And all of that is building heavy on our souls. We're hearing a lot about taking care of our mental health, but we also need to be focused on Christians as taking care of our spiritual health. And the irony of all of that is those two things are so deeply related to the community and body by which we belong and find life. And so it's all part of the great struggle of what we long for and long for what was. And I know this is new to us. I know this season is not something we've been through before. But it's not new. If we look at the grand arc of Scripture, at understanding God's redemptive story with His people, as we look at the human story. You see, we're used to this world where we can go where we want and do what we want whenever we want. And all of that has come to a screeching halt, and we long for what was. But as we look at the people of Israel, they long for the world that was lost to them as well. They long for Jerusalem. They long for the promised land. And more so than ever, I think we today can relate to that story of Scripture of God's people losing the promise, losing the blessings of God, at least in their perception. We can relate with the people of Isaiah 40 who long for the world that was conquered by Babylon. The people who long for the promise of God to be in the blessings of God. They long for Jerusalem because it's been lost and conquered by the Babylonian Empire. They long for their home because they've been taken as captives and exiles into a world that is not their own. They're living as slaves of the king and of the people of Babylon. And they're crying out to God, and they're not quite sure why God isn't listening. Any of that sound familiar to you? Because this is the story of Isaiah 40. And in the beauty of this story that we read in the book of Isaiah, the first line of chapter 40, because the end of chapter 40 is a verse that everybody uses and everybody says all the time. It's one of those memory verses that you hold on to, and you hold on to it deeply because it's so impactful in our lives. But do we understand its context? These are words spoken to a people in exile, a people who long for what was lost. And the first line of chapter 40 is this: "Comfort, comfort my people, says the Lord your God." You know, I've never walked up to somebody who's won the lottery and said, "Comfort, comfort my brother." I've never gone to somebody who's living a life of blessing and an easy life and everything's good and everything's going according to plan and walked up to them and gave them a hug and said, "Comfort, comfort, my friend." I don't think any of you have either. We comfort people in their time of loss. We comfort people in their time of need. We comfort people when their worlds have been shattered. When the world they hoped for is no more. "Comfort, comfort my people, says the Lord your God." Because Isaiah is drawing people into the promise of God, into the nature of God, and into the character of God. As you go deeper into Isaiah 40, that's where you'll hear this verse, this one that we quote all the time, that the grass withers and the flowers fade, but on the word of the Lord will endure forever. And Isaiah is reminding the people of God in their loss and in their mourning and what they have had to let go of. Isaiah is reminding them that this world is broken. This world you will struggle. This world you will have trials. And everything in this world will fade away. Everything. Including life. Nothing that we have is eternal. Nothing. And And then he reminds us so beautifully, the Word of God reminds us so beautifully that what we do have is an eternal promise from God. The Word of the Lord shall endure forever. Comfort, comfort, O my people. And right now we understand the Israelite story, don't we? We understand to long for what has been lost. We understand what it means to mourn what is no more. And right now, we wonder, does God hear our cries? What is God up to in this moment? Does He not hear our prayer? And that is what Isaiah is saying to the people. Why do you complain, O Jacob? That line actually just means, why are you complaining, Israel? Why are you complaining? My cause is disregarded by my God. But He doesn't care for my ways. Because that's what Israel's saying from captivity. My cause is disregarded by my God. Does He not hear our prayer? Does He not know the suffering that we're walking through? Does He not understand the worry and the fear of all that we have right now about our jobs and our finances and our lives and our health? Does God not care? Why do you complain, O Jacob? Might as well say, why do you complain, O church? Well, I got a whole list of reasons why, right? And so do the Israelites. They have a whole list of reasons why their complaint should be heard. Why isn't God doing something about this moment? Where is God at work right now? And that is the beauty of this passage. Because Isaiah, and I feel like this is a sarcasm voice, just personally. Do you not know? Have you not heard? That the Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. They're question marks. It's basically like Isaiah saying to you, saying to them and to us, has no one told you? Do you not know this about the nature of God and who He is? Do you not understand what God is and has done? And what He holds in His hands? Has no one told you that He's the creator of the ends of the earth? That He's the everlasting God that is eternal? You see, in our momentary struggles are nothing in comparison to the glory of God. That His glory is unfathomable. That His goodness is indescribable. His power and strength are not within our realm of understanding. Has nobody told you this? Do you not know this? That's what Isaiah is saying to the people of Israel, and I feel like it's what God is saying to us right now. Do you not know? And that's why our theology of creation matters so much, because we understand God as creator, maker of all things, then we understand that He holds this world and our lives in His hands, life and in death, no matter what it is. He's the creator of the ends of the earth. His glory is unfathomable. His goodness, indescribable. And Isaiah says, He gives that to you. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power
of the week.
Isaiah doesn't say, buck up, buttercup. He doesn't say, find that strength within you. You're Israel strong. You got this. Dig deep. You'll find that strength within. Isaiah says, when you're weary and you're tired and you're worn out, that he gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. He gives of that unfathomable glory, that indescribable power, he gives to you. He gives. For even young men will fall in exhaustion. Even the strongest and healthiest among you will fall. Yesterday we took the kids down to Grand Park to ride the bike trail down in Cranberry. And as we were finishing up, JD and I were out ahead a little bit. And so we pulled into the parking lot. We were waiting for Colt and Laura to catch up. And as we were waiting there, this guy came down the sidewalk, clearly tired, jogging. And he gets to this point where his girlfriend or wife, I don't know who it was holding a sign. I wasn't quite sure what was going on, but I had a sense, because as soon as he hit that sign, he hit the ground. He just fell over and laid on his back. And I thought to myself, I know that feeling. And then he said, that last six miles were just terrible. And I went, yep. Because today was supposed to be the Pittsburgh Marathon. And that young man had trained and decided he was going to run the marathon anyways. He had just finished a marathon. That is a no small feat. But you know what he did at the end? He stumbled and fell on the ground. I've done that. I've been there. Even young men will stumble and fall. But we weigh that against the eternal God, who does not grow weary or tired, who does not give up on us. So what do we need to do? For those who put their hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will rise on wings like eagles. They will soar. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. That word hope can be translated as trust or faith. See, friends, we have hope. And I have to admit that I'm weary. I'm tired. I've had enough. And I have stumbled and I have fallen more times than I'd like to admit in the last few weeks. Ready to give up. But we have hope. And it's not hope as in wishful thinking. It's hope in something that is eternal. Hope in something greater than ourselves. Hope that is assured. And that hope is not in science. It's certainly not in our politicians. That hope is not in the human spirit or the determination we have to carry on. None of those things in and of themselves are bad things. Actually, most of them are good. It's just that as Christians, that's not where we put our hope. That's not where we put our trust. That's not where we put our faith. We put it in Jesus alone. You see, we cheer on our medical workers and we cheer on our researchers and we pray and hope for a vaccine. We want a cure. We want to get back to normal life. But friends, our hope is not in any of those things. Our hope is in Jesus alone. It's not in doctors. It's not in the self. It's not in the human spirit. It's not in America strong. It is It is in one thing and one thing only. And His name is Jesus. His name is Jesus. When we put our hope and trust in Him, we live and rest on the promise that we are being renewed. Or it's Ephesians says that we are being made new in the attitudes of our minds, in our hearts. That we've taken off the old and we've put on the new. That when we put our hope and faith and trust in Jesus alone, even in the worst of times, we will soar like eagles. Eagles are majestic birds. I always find it fascinating that Ben Franklin wanted our national bird to be the turkey, right, instead of the eagle. I don't know if you knew that, so there's your lesson for the day. Eagles can fly up to 2 miles high, altitude of over 2 miles. It's amazing. But the interesting thing about eagles is they don't reach 2 miles because of their power or strength. The wingspans are up to 7 feet wide. And on those 7-foot wingspans are 7,000 feathers. If you ever watched an eagle fly, they're not like that hummingbird that just constantly is moving its wings. They soar through the air. They glide through the air. You know why? Not because of their power. It is their ability to catch the updraft of the air and those feathers under their wings. That's what allows them to soar to those heights. You see, it isn't their strength. It isn't their power. It's their ability to use the air that lifts them up. And I just can't help but Isaiah sitting there watching his world fall apart and crumble with the Hebrew people, watching those eagles fly above and resting on the promise that when we put our hope and faith and trust in Jesus like those eagles, we are lifted up. Not because of our power, and not because of our strength, and not because of our ability, but because we have put our hope and faith and trust in Jesus alone. Friends, in this season, in this moment, as we walk through the struggle, as we go through the trial, may we trust in Him. And knowing that when we do, we are being renewed. That we have to soar on wings like eagles. That our God lifts us up. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. Friends, let's now affirm what we believe in stating the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell, and on the third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Friends, as we end our worship today, and as we go back to this life that we are now all living, may we be reminded that as we put our hope and faith in Jesus in this moment, that we'll soar on wings like eagles, that He will lift us up. You are being renewed in the attitude of your mind when you put your hope and faith in Him and in Him alone. as we go from this place and from wherever we are, may God be gracious unto you and make His face to shine upon you. And until we meet again, may He hold you in the palm of His hand as we go in the love of God the Father, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, and the grace of the Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. May be with you now and forevermore. Amen.
When peace, my God,